We're continuing the walkthrough of the pixel renderer for Astortion. Last time we explored a technique called deferred shading, used for rendering lights. Today we'll combine it with the rest of the parallax pass to see the whole rendering process. But first we need to understand two other ingredients of this pass, parallax scrolling and upscaling. Parallax scrolling aims to simulate the effect caused by perspective, in which objects further away seem to move slower relative to the camera than objects that are closer. This happens because our eyes and cameras don't just gather the light that hits them directly, but rather use lenses that focus the light from a wider angle, increasing their field of view. You can see that the further away we are from the camera, the bigger the visible area gets, but its size with respect to the view remains the same. On the other hand, if we place a sphere in front of the camera and start moving it away, its size on the screen will decrease. This should be pretty intuitive. Here the circle takes half the visible area, and so its size is half that of the screen. But as we move further away, the proportions change. The visible area grows bigger, while the size of our sphere remains the same. The same thing happens with movement. If we place two spheres at different distances from the camera and move them by the same amount, they'll appear to travel different distances on the screen. This is exactly what causes the parallax effect. Of course, in most cases, it's the camera that's moving, but the result is the same. Our spheres move with the same velocity relative to the camera, but their speeds perceived on the screen are different. To simulate this effect with a simple 2D camera, first we need to separate objects into layers, based on how far away we want them to be. I plot these layers on a top-down view to better visualize that. I'll also mark the center of each layer. If we move the camera to the left, you'll notice that the centers of our layers are still perfectly aligned. Now imagine that we're using a perspective camera instead. For something like this to happen, all the centers need to lie on the same straight line passing through the camera, which means that the background layers moved further than the foreground ones. To fix this, we can use the central layer as the reference point and offset the rest to keep the travel distance the same. Going back to our simple camera, we can see how the layers are actually offset. We can use some trigonometry to figure out what this offset should be exactly. We know that this vector represents the displacement of the camera, and since these two triangles are congruent, we can say that the offset divided by the camera displacement is equal to the distance from the central layer divided by the distance from the camera. Solving for offset will give us the following formula. Notice how we don't really need specific values here, only the ratio between these two distances. This ratio is pretty handy when controlling the parallax effect. The value of 0 denotes the central layer. Negative values will move the layers to the foreground, and positive values will go to the background. All the way to 1, which will put the layer at an infinite distance from the camera. In practice, it means that the layer will appear static. This can be useful for things like the sky or sun that should always be visible. But we can go even further than that. Values above 1 will invert the parallax. It doesn't really make sense in our perspective analogy, but we can use it to create an illusion of a camera rotating around the center of the scene. This is the basic idea behind parallax scrolling. Now let's talk about upscaling. Astortion is first rendered in its native resolution. Here, pixels of the sprites have the same size as the pixels of the render texture. Once this is done, the texture can be scaled up to match the size of the screen. The result looks best if we scale the texture by a whole number. This ensures that each native pixel is represented by a square made up of screen pixels. In contrast, using non-integers would result in some pixels becoming rectangles. How the native resolution is selected could be a video on its own. For now, all you need to know is that, if possible, Astortion uses 480 x 270 pixels for gameplay, and for important cutscenes, 240 x 135 pixels. These resolutions nicely scale to the most common displays. The biggest advantage of upscaling is that it makes sure all procedural effects such as lights and shadows are pixel perfect. We also don't need to manually align our sprites to the pixel grid, since they'll end up pixelated regardless. This lets us repurpose a lot of assets by scaling and rotating them while keeping the style consistent. Going back to the bigger picture, the job of the parallax pass is to reconcile parallax scrolling with upscaling. The simplest approach would be to apply the parallax first and then upscale everything at once. But this makes the camera move in fixed steps, one native pixel at a time. Depending on what you're going for, this may be the desired effect. But with Astortion, I'd like to go the other way around. Upscale the parallax layers first to keep them pixel perfect, but then scroll them smoothly, independent of each other. So let's take a look at how to achieve this. Just like in the previous video, we start by preparing the G-buffer. But since we want the parallax layers to scroll independently, we'll need a way to render and store them individually. We can use the fact that the native resolution is relatively small and pack all layers into a single, bigger texture. Astortion uses a 4x4 layout, which results in 16 possible layers. But in this simple presentation, we'll only be using 4. We'll also store the transparency in our color texture. This will let us put the layers together later on. Let's start the rendering from the backmost layer. At this point, it should already be offset using our formula for parallax scrolling. But we also need to adjust the camera to align it with the pixel grid of this layer. This snapping will stabilize the pixelated sprites and effects, so they don't jitter when the camera is moving. Put a pin on this vector we used to offset the camera. We're gonna need it later. Lastly, we configure the rendering viewport so that the layer ends up in the correct spot, and then render all objects belonging to this layer. We repeat the same process for the remaining layers. Intuitively, rendering 16 layers like that may seem inefficient. In practice, however, the performance impact is negligible. Remember that the native resolution is tiny, so the overall area we actually need to render is roughly the size of a full HD texture. With the G-buffer ready, we can move on to the lights. Here we follow a similar process. Adjust the camera, set the viewport, render all lights from the layer, rinse and repeat. The final step is to upscale our layers and put them together. To achieve this, we'll prepare a dedicated mesh. It will consist of full-screen quads stacked on top of each other. Each will have the UV coordinates that map to the corresponding layer in our shaded color texture. Rendering this mesh using a simple orthographic projection will effectively scale up and merge our layers in one go. The resulting parallax isn't smooth though. This is where the offset vectors from our camera come into play. For example, when rendering this layer, we had to move the camera a little bit to the left. So now we'll move the quad for this layer by the same amount. This will neatly smooth out the camera movement. The last issue we need to address is this missing information around the borders. The solution is to extend the camera by one native pixel in each direction and expand our mesh to reflect that. This will give it enough padding to always cover the entire screen, even with the offset. Of course, it means that we need to expand the textures in our buffers to accommodate that. This is the general idea behind the parallax pass, but we're not finished yet. Having all the layers rendered separately opens the door to some interesting effects, such as depth of field and volumetric fog, which we'll cover in the upcoming videos. But that's all I've got for you today. Thanks so much to all my patrons, thank you for watching, and until next time.